Well, I'm very excited for this session, and these guys are at the cutting edge in the art and science of teaching, which is the name of the session. This will be this is being webcast live and video recorded, which is great because then we can refer back to it, share it with people. So I would like to introduce our session leaders, speakers, and then just let them get on with it. So first I would like to introduce Dr. Stephen Pollack from the Physics Department at the University of Colorado Boulder. Stephen was named the 2013 U.S. Professor of the Year by the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching. He studies student learning in large-scale physics classes and the constraints and opportunities involved in replicating proven curricular practices, as well as issues of gender gaps in introductory physics. He is known amongst his grad students as the human electron. Dr. Stephanie Chastain is a physicist and education researcher focusing on STEM educational reform. She is the associate director of the Science Education Initiative and independent consultant at the University of Colorado, Boulder. Dr. Chastain uses her skills in science, science communication, and education to support educational change programs at the University of Colorado and around the country, including providing resources and support to faculty, producing pedagogical videos, assessing programs, and researching characteristics of effective educational practice. So with that, take it away.
Okay. Thanks, Val. There's some instructions up front, so grab a clicker. Can everybody hear me okay? It's not too loud. All right. Take one of the clickers. You probably don't need to do anything except turn on the power button and then click A through E. And you'll know it's working because when you click it, it'll briefly flash green. So have you ever taken or taught a class that used clickers? Something like this. There's many, you know, different technologies, but they're this sort of idea. Or voting cards, which is a low-tech version of this, where you just hold up a little index card.
Raise your hand if you need another clicker.
Here. And if you're finding that you're having some techno problem, somebody else at your table might be able to help you figure it out. Okay, so we've got about 50 votes here. I'm going to sort of move on, but this is your voice right now in this room, so it's helpful if you can get this thing working. And, you know, when I'm teaching large lecture classes, and I wouldn't call this a large lecture, I'm teaching 300 students this semester. This is sort of a typical, you know, large state university introductory level class. There's all sorts of questions that I can ask that really help me to figure out what's going on. So for instance, right now, we are all over the map, yeah. So that's good for me to know. And not a single person voted E, other. It's complicated. I like to give you the option of, like, I don't fit into a bin, I'm a human being, right? And often, like, I'll then say, okay, who voted E? Like, tell me what you want to say, because that's like an opportunity for you to get your voice heard. So this is all over the map. I'm not, you know, selling products. This is a tool, like one of many tools that we'll be telling you about to try to allow some communication in this room. This is a picture of me in the upper division electrodynamics course that I took a couple years ago. And this is in the middle of lecture. So something different is happening in this room than just me at the blackboard explaining to students as clearly as I can the rules of Maxwell's equations, right? So I'm speaking to a few students. If you look in the background, some students are working on their own. Over in the upper left-hand corner, some students are talking to each other. That one happens to be smiling. It's always a nice bonus. There's somebody like standing up in the back. That's an undergraduate who took the class the previous semester. We call him a learning assistant. I pay him. He comes back and helps me. So that, you know, there's all sorts of stuff that we do in this classroom, as well as me lecture. You'll find, you know, I'm lecturing right now. So there's certainly a time for that. Title of this talk, The Art and Science of Teaching. So I noticed already when we came in, people were saying, well, I'm looking forward to your talk on the art of teaching. So you know, that I'm a physicist, and so I want to include the word science in the title in part because otherwise I can't keep my job at the physics department at the University of Colorado. You know, I'm going to make some claims, which is that there is both obviously an art and there is a science to teaching, and I think it's useful to be aware of that. Let me ask you this. How many of you think that the odds are greater than 50% that someday you'll be teaching an undergraduate class? I just want to get a, oh, lots of hands. So let me invert that. How many of you are pretty sure that you're never going to be teaching undergraduate class? So nobody is willing to raise their hand for that one. Okay, good. So, you know, then it's appropriate that we spend a little bit of time here. We've already been introduced. Stephanie, do you have any additional introduction that you need to make right now?
No.
Okay.
I'll be pitching in.
Good. So I'm going to be telling you a little bit about ideas from physics education research, but you know I'm aware that like this room is people in a related but separate discipline, and so the physics part is not really the key element here. You know, you have to acknowledge your colleagues and your funding sources whenever you give a talk. Part of the point here is that the font is almost so small that you can't read it. There's a lot of people at CU Boulder who are interested in and working on questions of physics education, and if you expand this to blank education research, like geophysics education research, or chemistry education research, or engineering, all of a sudden, you know, there's like lots of people at the university. We have discipline-based education research meetings going on. So it's very active, and boy, I feel like this is just a little bit loud. Over a little bit. So, when you are looking at an institution, you're trying to get a job, and you're thinking about your teaching statement, we won't be saying too much about that, but maybe a little bit. It is useful to find out whether there is a big community of education research at the place you're interested in. Some schools do, some schools don't, and it depends also on the discipline. Physics is, kind of has a long tradition of education research. It's more common to find, and it's worth just learning a little bit about that, because you don't want to advertise yourself as being an education researcher if you're not, but you'd like to be aware of education research so that you can use it in your teaching. Okay, so a little quick lesson here. Raise your hand if you know about Traxylene. You know what Traxylene is? Okay, I'm going to teach you. It is very important to learn about Traxylene. Traxylene is a new form of zionter. It's mantled in Seristana. The Seristanians found that they could gristerlate large amounts of fervon and then bractor it to quasal Traxylene. That was my little mini lesson. And, you know, there's an awful lot of science classes that look like this, at least to the students. So, okay, so I've given you a lesson. If this was, in fact, a class where I felt it was important that you learn about Traxylene, I would surely have a test or some homework problem. So I'm going to give you a test now. Okay, so better read it again. Actually, I'm going to leave it up so that, you know, it's like an open book test. And here you go. Just think, can you answer these questions? What is Traxylene? Where is it, Montiel? So how many of you feel that you would get an A or a B on this test? Raise your hand. Really? You can't tell me where it's Montiel's? Could you please read the paragraph again? You know. Raise your hand if you think you'd pass this test. Yeah, I think you would all pass this test. I know you could, because you're postdocs, right? You've passed many tests like this in your life. So, and you know, so part of the point here is I don't want for students to think that this is what science is. Memorizing nonsense and repeating back words without having any understanding. You know, I think these questions would feel to an instructor like they were good questions, and I would find out if you know about Traxylene. Maybe if I ask this one, I said it's important, but why is it important? All of a sudden, that's a little bit tougher. Now, actually, if I asked you this question, you'd say, why is it important? Oh, because it's a new form of zionter. So, you know, you'd BS your way, and you'd hope that the professor would give you an A for that answer. Okay. If I asked you, how could the Seristanians improve the Traxylene production process? Now you're totally lost, right? So I would claim that you don't know anything about Traxylene. I know that because it's nonsense. And yet, you know, this all feels like a science class. So as we move on, you know, you're welcome to say Traxylene, you know, which is sort of a coded indication that all of a sudden I'm speaking nonsense. So Stephanie, let me let you start an activity. Okay. Oh, is that mic to mic? Yeah, okay.
So to sort of compare the montylation of Traxylene to what we know can really work in education, I want you to get a chance to think about something that has really worked for you in any STEM course that you've taken. Think of, and STEM is science, technology, engineering, math, so it could be within geology, geosciences, but it doesn't have to be. Think of something that was a really transformational experience. And if you can't think of a transformational one, at least one that was positive. And what about that experience was transformational or important? Why did you value that experience? What were you able to do as a result of that learning? So think about how it is that you were different, how it was you were transformed, what it is you are able to add to your life as a result of that learning. So I want you to just think about that for 20 seconds. Try to get something in your head. So hopefully you'll have some ideas starting to form. So I want you to now turn and talk at your tables and share what that transformational experience was and why you valued that experience so highly. Go.
Stuff. Tried that and failed. It's tough to find papers in physics that are accessible to undergrads. We keep trying to identify good readable papers that, because physics doesn't have a good tradition of writing papers that are accessible to undergrads. It's just, shall we just?
Yeah. I was going to give him maybe another minute.
Okay.
Does my mic seem loud enough? It feels quiet.
Oh, mine feels too loud.
Yeah, no, yours. But I mean, when I had my, you can't.
You could ask the AV people, but I thought it was fine. So are you going to take a few minutes to get a couple of ideas?
Yeah, hear a few ideas. Take another few seconds to wrap up your current train of thought.
Just turn it off when I'm talking.
Okay, let's come back together and hear some of the ideas that came up. So we're not going to have time to hear like all of the great discussions that I hope you just had. I heard some really great ones. But I want to hear just a couple of things from a couple of tables. Some of the things that came up, like what was the experience that was valuable, and what made you value that experience so highly? Anyone want to volunteer? Not, then I'll pick a table.
No, watch for the wait time here.
So.
Yeah, do you want to?
I said at our table, we realized that people had interpreted the question very differently, and someone had kind of answered with, this was a course that I took, and this element I liked, and now my research is on that topic, or that's how I got into this field, or something. And I thought you meant what was a something specific about how a course was structured that was transformed how you think, which is kind of very teaching related, but and mine was like about teaching me to distill information better through like some exercises.
So there are different ways that we can be transformed by teaching experiences. Maybe the content actually informed our future choices, or maybe something about the way that it was taught changed the way that we think or the way that we approach a problem. You know, both are I think very valuable. Since this is a session on the art and science of teaching, I'm thinking more of like what kinds of teaching techniques brought you to a place of new thinking, but they're both valid. Other volunteers? See, in the very back. Yeah. Thank you to the microphone carriers.
At our table, we kind of stuck within physics, talking about quantum physics and heliophysics. But essentially, the common theme is that we thought it was very powerful for professors and lecturers to kind of teach with examples that are relatable to the class and really get at this larger aspect of kind of teaching the practice of science to a larger audience.
So the teaching the practice of science, not just the facts, not just the montelation of Traxler and stuff, but how you actually do it, how you formulate a hypothesis, how you think about drawing conclusions, is that what you mean? Okay, so those sorts of things we might call skills in addition to attitudes. We've got time for one more. There was someone at this table before. Yep.
So my example was about a geophysical fluid dynamics class where we did rotating tank experiments or demonstrations to show, how weather forms, like what causes baroclinic instability. And I found that really powerful because we write all the equations down for what, governs that. But when we did the tank experiment, it was very clear that it was rotation plus temperature gradient. And so like being able to like get that conceptual sort of understanding, to complement the rigorous math, I found really powerful, and it made it easier than to say to anyone, "Well, it causes weather." You're like, "Oh, well, rotation and temperature gradients." There you go.
There's the focus on conceptual understanding, so you really could kind of make predictions or understand how that worked. So this is great. Since everyone said that they would be most likely teaching undergraduates, I think it's really important to reflect on what experiences you found particularly valuable for yourself, and talk to other people about what they find valuable, because those are the sorts of things that you want to emulate. And one thing you might have noticed as reflecting on your experience, sometimes those experiences are rare, and they're not how we were usually taught. But it's much easier to teach in the way that we were usually taught, which is typically lecture at the blackboard. So think about those experiences that stand out. And if you're thinking about applying for teaching jobs in the future, those might be the sorts of things you might want to capture, for instance, on a teaching statement to sort of explain your vision or philosophy of teaching.
So I just wanted to say a word about education research, because one of the things I want to encourage you to do is after this meeting and while you're writing your applications, is to think a little bit about what your discipline's education research looks like. Within physics, so the first line is really critical. This is research studies done by physicists. So it is not, for instance, the research literature that comes out of the educational psychology departments or the School of Education. That's super valuable, and we use that. But I think in order to talk to physicists about teaching physics, it's been sociologically really important and helpful that it's coming out of physics departments. And I was sort of trying to distill what PER looks like. I think one element is how do students, and I'm thinking how do adults, learn science? So mechanism. And you know, I sort of point at my head because that's where I kind of think that learning happens, but there's a lot of people in the education research community who would not point at your own head, but think about the fact that learning is a social enterprise, and in fact, learning physics is in part socializing you into the world of physics, and therefore the learning mechanisms have to do with the interactions you're having with other people, and not just, you know, rewiring your own brain. So all of that goes in here. The next is, how do we know they're learning? This is hugely important. So you start to, when you're thinking about this, you start to articulate what it is that you would like to be able to assess, and then how could we assess it? So I think some of those questions, those exam questions about Traxeline that I showed you, are not very good measures of the kind of learning that I would like my students to be able to demonstrate. And it's highly non-trivial. There's been a lot of work done in trying to think about how do you know that they're learning. It's not always tests, it's observations and conversations, and there's all sorts of ways. The third is the one that probably everybody in this room, you know, is like, gimme, right? How do we help them learn? Because, you know, you want to go and be a good teacher right from the start, or convince somebody that you're going to be a good teacher if you're still trying to get jobs. When I started in this area of research, actually before I started in this area of research, I did theoretical nuclear physics, and I taught because I was an assistant professor. And so I would listen to PER talks, and I read some of their papers, and I was just interested in the bottom line. And what I took me a while to appreciate is that you can't help students learn until you start thinking about how do adults learn and how would we know that they're learning. So I think these things all tie together. So you know, we're not up here kind of trying to give you teaching tips. In part, you know, there's lots of individuality about the art side of teaching that I wouldn't want to try to suggest you teach the way I do, but to start to think about these questions. And, you know, I'm in a physics department, so we all get labeled. Are you a theorist? Are you an experimentalist? Or do you do applied physics? And so, you know, that's sort of how I helped come up in my own mind with these categories. And because it's a young field, you can do all three. You know, if you're normally in the physics department, you are one or the other, theorist, experimentalist, applied. Let's do another clicker question. So this is a question from the Force Concept Inventory. It's a research-based assessment instrument developed 25 years ago by physicists. And you're looking down, so there's the head of a person, and they're swinging, maybe it's a dog toy or something with a tennis ball at the end. They're swinging it around their head, and at point P, the rope snaps. So go ahead, let's see, the clicker system is on, so you can vote. Which path, viewed from above by a stationary observer, would you see the ball follow after the rope snaps, A, B, C, D, or E? Now, there's a little bit of stress in the room because you're all postdocs, and you're thinking, I should know the answer to this, and probably you do. But you know, the reality is that the undergrad freshmen in my class also feel that stress, and there's some value to that stress. And it's anonymous, right? Put the clicker down here and vote. Okay, did you notice how many clicks we were getting? Has everybody voted? I thought it was 50, so if you haven't voted, don't forget, you might have to turn the power back on. Make sure that it flashes when you press. And you can change your mind, right? It records all the votes, but only the last one counts. So,
and
is this
again,
your final answer?
If anyone's having trouble, you can just raise your hand. We've got more clickers.
Okay, well, that's interesting. Those of you who waited the longest did the worst, because the score just went down. I'm going to have you... answer another question, and I'm going to have you talk to your neighbors this time. And so in the process of talking to your neighbors, you're welcome to check in about this physics. You might think about the nature of this question and whether this is one of my Traxeline questions or something rather different. In particular, let me emphasize that the questions on the FCI, this inventory, are never asked during the semester. So I would ask this question at the beginning of the term, then we would teach for instance, when an object is in circular motion, what is its velocity vector at point P? What direction is it traveling? And then we would talk about Newton's laws, and I would say an object in motion remains in motion. That's Newton's first law. And I would have some examples, but none of them would look like this. I don't want my students memorizing the answers, because then I haven't figured out if they can put ideas together. At the end of the semester, I'll ask the question again. So what I want you to talk about with your neighbors is, at the University of Colorado up the street, a big public institution for the algebra-based students, so that's probably not the physics course that you took, probably took a calc-based physics course. This would be the integrated physiology majors. They want to be doctors, they want to be nurses, vets, physical therapists, and then, you know, there's some architects, right? It's a bunch of people in this room. How difficult is this question for them? So take 1 minute, talk with your neighbors, vote as soon as you, you know, you can vote now and then change your mind. I just want you to... this is before. Before they, so they walked in the door, I give it as a pretest. And you can think in your group about how they're going to do at the end of my course. I will tell you in a minute. Good. What do you think? Is there a consensus in your group? Really? Yeah, okay. What do you think physics professors think the answer to this question is? Okay, folks, I'm going to collect this one. So vote if you haven't already voted. We had about 50 people clicking away. Remember, it has to flash green. So if it's not flashing, you know, you can press it a bunch of times. I hear students in my room like click, 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 click. Okay, oh, that's an interesting distribution. So let me show you. Sometimes in class it's really helpful to stop a question and then show the histogram. So kind of a split between C and D with half a dozen of you saying, how could I know this? Okay, so the lesson here, so it's not a wrong answer. You're not physics professors, so you know, what is the answer to E? How could you know this? Just read a paper. I mean, there's all sorts of literature about student difficulties, and if a concept inventory exists, there will also be papers that will tell you how do students in different populations do. You know, the answer to this question is it's different for the algebra-based and the calc-based students. And so the answer to E is just read a paper or two about the teaching of the course that you're going to be teaching and you'll know the answer. So I will forgive you for voting E, but you know, if you're going to teach the material, don't stop voting E, all right? How could you know it? Learn about it. People do research on this stuff. As for the rest of you, yeah, I mean, it's really hard to guess if you haven't taught freshman physics. In my class last year, at the beginning, the answer was at least very difficult. So the score on this was approximately 50%. So half the students can answer it and half cannot. And you know, if I call A, like 90%, and B, you know, like 80%, then my students are failing on this question. At the end of the semester, okay, now this is the part that I have to hang my head a little bit. You might think, oh, come on, Steve, US Professor of the Year. So the score on this particular question goes up from 50 to 75. So it's good progress, okay? Let me put it this way. They had 50 points they could have gained on average, right? And they gained half of that. So the normalized gain is 50%. They gained half of what they didn't already know. By normalizing the gain, I can compare my students with students at a community college who walk in the door getting 20%, because that's random guessing, or at Harvard, where they walk in the door getting 75%, as well as my students walk out the door. And so, you know, if I just compared how much they gained without dividing by how much they could have gained, I can't compare CU instruction with Harvard instruction. So let me show you a histogram of how universities across the U.S. do on a 33-question test that's all like this. So it's all conceptual. You don't ever... Pardon?
I don't think we've got the histogram.
Oh, we're not there yet. Okay. So then...
I'll show the
Oops, sorry. Didn't want to do that. Ah, very good. One more activity before I show you the data.
Yeah. So we wanted to give you a chance to see what these sorts of concept inventory questions look like in a discipline that's perhaps a little more familiar to you. So we have pulled some questions from the geoscience concept inventory, which is in development, so it's an earlier stage than the force concept inventory. We have less data on how students actually do on these questions. I'm going to give you these questions in a moment, but first I want to frame, let go of trying to just argue about the answer. It's really hard to do when you look at the questions, but what you want to be thinking about is to try and to get into your student's head. I mean, think about what the answer is, but then focus most of your discussion on what do you think our students are going to answer? Why are they going to answer that way? What are the going to be the sort of tempting wrong answers for your students? So, question?
You make it up, right? I mean, everybody in this room has some. The question was, which student population are you thinking about? And until you're teaching a class, you don't know.
Yeah. But these are all fairly introductory, and we tried to take a smattering of different topics. So face down on your tables is this sheet. It says questions from the geoscience concept inventory. You've only got a few minutes to do this, so don't get too stuck on any one question, but discuss what you think the right answer is and what you think your students are going to answer and why.
Nope. Do we have extras? So you thought we were going to be done with this activity now, roughly?
Yeah, we're asking when I was ambitious, organized, so we're going to
be on it. Okay. Yeah, I think so. Just a few minutes. Okay.
Gets up in the stratosphere, reflects more heat.
Cool. There's climate records have shown.
Yeah.
So your group is being very quiet. I might encourage you at this point to just. One of you who sees something that's like triggering an idea, let's like sort of talk a little bit about that one question.
Hi. Yes, please do. Yeah.
Yes, and why are they answering the wrong answers? Like, where is that coming from? I can't turn it off. It won't turn off. Not very long. I think it's not important for them to like get too far in this. It's more that they looked at it and thought about it.
I've never taken
gravity. Neither.
Neither have I.
Gravity's always a good answer.
Yeah.
Take another 30 seconds to finish your train of thought.
Yes.
Yeah,
you can imagine it moving around on the lava.
Yeah.
Okay, let's come back together. In the interest of time, We're not going to go through every single one of these. We'll see if we can get to two. But so whoever volunteers, pick a meaty one. Any volunteers to talk about one of the questions that you talked about and where you think students might go wrong? I do have the right answers now. Of course, I didn't write these questions. Why don't we pick the question first, and then we'll... is there one that you think is particularly rich? Like, as a non-geoscience person, I don't know which one is going to be give us the richest conversation. Two? Okay, so number two. Any brave souls to talk about why you think the... What the right answer is, you think, and why? In a group of geoscientists. Thank you, brave soul.
I was gonna say I don't like any of the answers.
So it's definitely tempting to pick apart the question, and not knowing the question, the answers. But. Right. Well, the answers are part of the question. I don't want to get into picking apart the particular question. I'll go ahead and do the reveal in that I was told by the person who authored the question that the answer was D. Do you guys like that answer?
More than the others, yeah.
Right. Raise your hand if you think that D is not a good answer just from a scientific standpoint. Okay, so there is something called question validation where you go through and make sure that the answer choices that you've chosen are good answer choices. But let's assume that this is the best answer for this particular question for the moment, and we'll try to rewrite the question. What do you think students might answer to this? How might their thinking go astray on this question?
We thought at our table, that students might get it backwards and think that earthquakes caused the plate motion because they know that the two are associated.
Mm-hmm. So that they connect earthquakes with plates, and so they just sort of don't really understand the underlying mechanism. And so they just sort of regurgitate something that's not correct because they've got the wrong mechanism in mind. So these are really helpful to go through and think about just exactly this question, where your students might go wrong and what you might do to help them with those ideas, what activities you would do in class if you found on a pretest that students were answering incorrectly to some of these questions. So the full concept inventory is at that link on the top of the page, and you can go, and it's actually a wiki, and you can input your discussion as to why you think that there should be a different answer choice, for example, because this one's still in development. So it's really helpful in physics that we do have a lot of data on student responses to questions like the force concept inventory question, because we know just where students tend to go wrong, what difficulties they tend to have, and have done research on what kind of teaching helps to impact those difficulties. There is also some research in the geosciences on common student misconceptions, so I thought I'd just sort of share some of those. We tend to like to call them student difficulties rather than misconceptions, just because it's a general area that students struggle. They might not have a well-formed opinion yet. But some people do think that summer occurs when Earth is closer to the sun. That's a pretty common one. That's been documented in astronomy as well as geoscience classes. Holes in the ozone layer are the reason that global warming is happening. That's a commonly held belief about climate change. And then floating continents, that underneath the continents, there's some layer of liquid that the continents are floating on. And
why else would they call it drift?
Yeah. Okay. So just to sort of center your thinking in your discipline, this is some content about the geosciences, but now we're going to go back to physics land. So go ahead and...
Okay. When you read literature, you find websites or research that tells you information like this, and you're about to teach the topic of seasons, the idea here isn't to tell your students, now don't think that the reason why it's hotter in the summer is because we're closer to the sun. That's not going to be very effective. Knowing these is just the beginning of thinking about how best could you help your students to make sense Because, you know, there's, I would say number one is good scientific thinking. It's just wrong. I mean, when I'm closer to a hot thing, it's hotter. So there is some good logic that sits behind that. It's not even necessarily bad science, except that it's wrong because there's other reasons that are much more important. So, you know, we have a few ideas for this session, and we've articulated them. So lesson number one, know your audience, is, you know, it's sort of obvious. I noticed that this was also the statement that was made at the end of the previous presentation. It's so obvious that sometimes you lose sight of it. There's a tendency, and I fall victim to this myself, that you think your student is a bunch of little mini-yous, just younger, right? So you're teaching to yourself, you're thinking, how would I have learned this idea the best? And then, you know, you go to the board and you give the clearest explanation you can. Knowing your audience is super powerful. It's very difficult, especially when you're a new teacher. So finding the literature is one way to do it. Another is to, we'll show you some ways that you can find out what your students think on the fly. Formative assessment is the sort of idea that all the time, these clicker questions don't count against your grade in my class. As you're voting, I'm getting information, you're sharing information. It's a communication tool, it is not a test. So that, you know, that can be very powerful. And so knowing what they know already, so that you can bridge them from what they believe and what they think to where you want them to be, way better than just assuming that they don't know anything, because that's not true either. So this was part of this force concept inventory. I told you about my scores on this particular question. Here is a histogram of the overall learning gain, that normalized learning gain. So I don't know if you could read this axis. It starts at zero. It doesn't even bother going up to 100% because nobody ever gets close to that. This is 6,000 students at a dozen universities. It's a big meta study by Richard Hake. It was published in the American Journal of Physics almost 20 years ago. Many, many physicists, especially 20 years ago, read AJP. It was like one of the big journals for us. And so we all kind of saw this graph and started scratching our heads. This is a disaster, right? This peak, this is a histogram of learning gains, it's peaking at 25%. So that means that if the students start with a 50, they go a quarter of the way. So what's a quarter of 50? You know, it's like 12 points. So they go from a fail to a D, right? It's really depressing. And so now, you know, people started asking all sorts of questions. One of the things that people did was to look at the questions on the FCI and start picking them apart. Well, if you take into account special relativity, that answer's wrong. But, you know, that's not what the issue was with the freshmen. Another thing that, you know, that was almost universal was, and I did it myself, not my class. I don't believe it, right? Like, this is education data. It's noise. You know, people tried to replicate this, and it's really easily replicable data. So for 20 years, people have been giving the force concept inventory, and this is what you will score if you stand and lecture, and you can explain, you can know about those misconceptions, and you can carefully explain them to your students, and they'll still gain about 25% on this kind of a test. So what's going on? What's the reasons? Well, you know, we've been talking about reasons. One of them is just, it's like how our classes are built. So here's a picture of a classroom. It's a good classroom, at least it was. It was the best classroom. It's a state of the art 2,000 years ago. And now I'm going to show you my classroom up at CU, which I'm going to be teaching in tomorrow. Kind of the same room, isn't it? Right? Like, we can teach at night now and when it's raining. But otherwise, fundamentally, it's the same idea. Rows of obedient students listening, scribing down what I'm saying so that the knowledge of the professor can go into the notebook of the students without passing through the mind of either. Right? So, you know, this is a problem, and it's a problem you will all face. This is my classroom. I got to deal with it. So I got to think about ways to leverage that physical space and do the best I can with it. There is a theoretical models of how people learn that I mentioned. I'm going to show you a diagram of a conventional model of teaching and learning called the transmissionist model. The idea is I know stuff, I'm speaking, now you know it. So here's the diagram. So, you know, it's easy to make fun of. There's a lot of things in this picture that are connected with the transmissionist model. So students are empty, they're passive. Learning is a thing. They get filled up. They go off into the factory, right? There's so many elements about this that you're just thinking, oh, that's all wrong. And yet, kind of, this underlies how I started teaching. I thought, basically, this is what learning is you guys are listening to me, and now you know stuff about teaching that you didn't know before. And, you know, one of the contrasting theories to transmission is construction. So you are master learners. I know this, because you're postdocs. There's no way you could be here without being a truly masterful learner, which means that you are engaged with me right now. You're questioning everything that I'm saying. You're connecting it to your own teaching experiences. You're already starting to think about applications. You're doing all the things I want students to do. But, you know, you're not really being passive. You're actually being very active, even if you're silent right now. And in my freshman class, I got plenty of data that suggested that almost none of the students are like you. So we have to make it explicit. We have to start talking about what it means to learn in the classroom. So this is the buzzword. I hope it's not Draxeline. Interactive engagement. So there's two parts to that, interactive and engagement. So, you know, I've had faculty members who say, well, I'm pretty engaging. You know, I got a charming British accent, one of my colleagues, and, you know. So, you can be engaging, but that's different than interactive. So the idea here is that students need to be building ideas in your classroom all the time. And they can only do that based on what they know. So you have to know what they know. And there needs to be feedback. You got to be thinking all the time when you're teaching about local feedback, what's happening right now that's giving you an idea of whether what you're learning is correct and making sense and allowing you to move forward. So I'm going to do another little mini lesson. How many of you have had a formal lesson in refraction? At some point, oh, so almost everybody. So okay, this is a little review. I've got a light ray coming in. Already there's some issues, like I'm representing light as a black arrow, so you got to think about what that means. It's coming from air and it's hitting a block of glass. What does it do? So, if I'm in lecture mode, that's what you might think if you're an introductory student, that light goes through glass, so it goes in a straight line. But it doesn't. Here's what light does. It refracts. And so we can start to think about how would we describe this, not explain it, but describe it. So one thing I might do would be to define the geometry of the situation. So I would draw, I would identify some number that characterizes the two media, index of refraction, N1 in the top, N2 down below. So there's a number that tells me something about light. And then I might want to identify a normal, right? That little dashed line is perpendicular to the surface, and now I can label angles. And, you know, there's an ambiguity. Should I label that one theta 1, or should I label its complement theta 1? It's a convention, and I decided to label this one theta 1. And by naming it this way, I can write down a law, which was discovered experimentally, empirically, long, long time ago. N1 sine theta 1 equals N2 sine theta 2. And if this was a traditional lecture, I've got my lovely PowerPoints, and I was as clear as I could be, and I think we're done with this topic. You can now solve homework problems, and, you know, if the homework problem is N1 is 1, theta 1 is 20 degrees, N2 is 1.4, calculate theta 2, you can all do that and, you know, feel like you've learned about refraction. But, you know, I would say there's lots more to refraction. One thing that I would certainly do at this moment in my class, and I might actually give this lecture, because this formula is going to be useful for the student understanding. At Colorado and all over the country, but Colorado has this site. How many of you know about FET, P-H-E-T? Oh, check it out, phet.colorado.edu. It's like hundreds now of sims. They simulate everything. It started off as physics, but now it's got, you know, glaciers and climate change and radiation and chemistry and biology. So I pulled up the, there's one on bending light. And so you can mess around. You know, here's my little laser beam. Ooh, I just discovered that there's also reflection. And I can, you know, I can mess around. So you get this, you can do this in front of the students. Better yet, get the students to mess around with the sim on their homework so that they can, you know, see for themselves what happens. You know, everything's sort of live. If I change the index of refraction of the glass, notice that the refracted ray changes angles when the two are equal, and there's a little number that's showing up, so I can connect this to the formula. The light goes through in a straight line. So, you know, messing about at this stage of learning can be very productive. And then I go back. And maybe in class, the next thing that I might do would be to ask this question. So let me let you vote on it. Talk with your neighbors right away about this. So let me read it for you. A ray of light passes through a sheet of glass. Oh, but it doesn't have parallel surfaces anymore. I've made it thick at the bottom and thin at the top. So it comes in. There's glass. It's got a larger index of refraction. Which path will it follow when it comes back out again, A, B, or C, just qualitatively? I claim you can answer this question with N1 sine theta 1 equals N2 sine theta 2, but it also requires some drawing and some thinking. You've got paper and pencils, you know. Have at it for a minute. A is bent towards the thin end, B is undeviated, C is bent towards the thick end. Many of you know the answer to this from your real life experiences or from previous classes. That's fine, you can vote the correct answer, but in my class, the discussion is about the reasons, not the answer. So that's, you know, if you're voting whatever, D, because you know that's the right answer, you may convince everybody at your table to vote D, but when I call on your table and you say, because Steve said so, yeah. Okay, take a moment. We're not going to spend very long. The point here is not for you to study refraction. And in fact, you can immediately go meta and think about, what am I learning here? Is this a Traxlene kind of question? What, you know, what's the nature of this question? Would it be valuable? Okay. Just discuss. let me think. I'll move a little bit. We won't spend too long on this either. And has nobody, oh, you've started drawing. You've started drawing. Yeah, I would walk around my room and say, if you don't draw something, you can't figure this question out unless you know the answer. Yeah. And even drawing it, there's, you know, it's a non-trivial question. So you're answering the question, and I'm not seeing a sketch. And I can't imagine, oh, she's sketching, but she's like way over on the other side of the table. I can't imagine how I could answer this question without drawing a picture. So I would walk around my room and tell my students, you know, please, just start drawing. You could try. I find it hard. I mean, this is just complicated enough for me. I lose track of, like, what's happening. The picture here is, for me, it's worth 1,000 words.
Obviously, you know the word wave, so you didn't use it in ray. So I'm assuming that a ray of light is some total of waves that equate to white light.
Yeah, think of a laser pointer. It is a wave phenomenon, but you can think of it as a ray as well.
So this could be a ray of any given wavelength.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Monochromatic makes it simpler. If there's multiple colors, you'll have a prism, and there'll be like a slight. It's really small. The difference. So whichever one you're voting, A, B, or C, the difference for the different colors will be a really, really small effect. It's enough if you get far enough away that you can see the rainbow, but it's not the dominant effect. The dominant effect is just this one. Like any ray will deviate either A, B, or C direction.
Oh, I see.
Okay, so, you know, this is a fun question, and I bet we could leave you for 20 minutes and everybody would have the answer, and that might be what I would do in class. But we've got, you know, other things to talk about, not the physics of light. I just wanted to give you a moment to experience, you know, what it's like to be in a classroom that is a mix of teacher lecturing, but also you sitting in small groups, arguing, thinking. I could pull up the FET sim, and I will just recommend that, you know, oops, if you... if you want to mess with this, you go to the prisms part of the FET sim, and oh, it just so happens that I have such a such an object, and I can turn on my beam and answer the question. Now, this isn't explaining it, but at least I know what the answer is, and I actually get some insights. Like as I mess around, I sort of discover what happens when we come in at different angles, and right, there's a lot that you can actually begin to develop intuitions. But it always is bending towards the thick part, which begins to explain what's happening. Why are glasses thick in the middle and thin at the top and bottom? Well, for some of us, actually, my glasses are not like that. My glasses are thin in the middle and thick at the top and bottom because, you know, next in class, what we would do after students have learned about this, certainly if it was my algebra-based class, would be to, I'm not going to walk you through my explanation, would be to talk about eyes. Because in my algebra-based class, there's at least 30 people out of 300 whose career is going to be, you know, they want to be opticians. And so all of a sudden, they're at the edge of their seats. And I can explain, you know, far-sighted eyes versus near-sighted eyes. And I will then have a clicker question where I show a close-up view of two people wearing glasses. And I say, which one's near-sighted? Which one's far-sighted? Just by looking at them and what their face looks like behind the glasses, if you've made sense of refraction, you can actually answer that question. So this connection to people's lives is going to be part of the story, which we didn't have yet. But, you know, it doesn't have to come right at the start. Sometimes it does. My colleague Michael Dobson drew this cartoon about teaching. I claim it's a picture of me because I used to have a beard, but he says it's not. So here's me or somebody teaching the Gaussian exponential function. And I worked on this lesson. I may have forgotten the Gaussian exponential function until last night, but as I was preparing my lecture notes, it's now so clear to me, right? And if only I could get into the heads of my students, it would vastly improve my ability to help them to understand the Gaussian exponential function. Now, the point of this cartoon is not to make fun of students, right? The idea here is that everybody's looking at this and making sense of it in their own way based on where they're coming from. And I'm not even making fun of that student because, you know, there's people in my class who are working two jobs and they're exhausted. And so, you know, part of what I'm thinking about is if I'm aware of this, I can try to figure out what's going to wake them up in my classroom. I'm not seeing that person in this room yet, but we're not done yet. So I showed you the dismal learning gains in traditional lectures. Here's data from that same 1998 publication on what happens in interactive engagement classrooms. And, you know, this was published, and CU said, not us. But in fact, it wasn't us, because we immediately started doing interactive engagement right away. We saw this paper. It was like, of course we should be doing this. It just seemed so natural. Here's the CU data. And so, education data. It is replicable, and lots of institutions have produced the same plot. Typically, junior faculty, that's me. You know, that's why you get the Carnegie Professor of the Year Award, is you fall into that bin. It's still only, you know, 60% learning gains. So we've still, you know, got a long way to go. Typically, junior faculty move up. So that's also inspiring, right? It means that as you teach and you learn how to teach, you get better at it like anything. I mean, if it was just an art, then you might say to yourself, I don't know, I'm just not a natural born teacher. And that would be a really destructive attitude to have. Everybody, you know, people send their kids to piano lessons. So, and they don't say, well, you're either a pianist or you're not. Like, there's no point in taking lessons. So lesson number two, interactive engagement works. And you know, I got decades of data that suggests that you can't teach students, they teach themselves. And so this style of classroom is demonstrably more effective. It changes learning gains by factors of two or three. And so it's huge. And you know, this little quip, teachers show you where to look, not what to see. I didn't write that one. And now I'm thinking about whether I agree with it or not. But anyway, it's my PowerPoint, and I'm sticking with it. So let me quickly just sort of mention ways that people have developed. There's a million ways, and everybody kind of figures out their own. I've been showing you about clickers and peer instruction. I think of this as, it's still lecturing. It's a part of lecturing. And you know, you intersperse questions, they should be challenging. And the element here that is really crucial is the peer instruction. So when faculty give clicker questions and it's silent in the room and the students think and vote and then you move on, the learning gains aren't nearly as much. It's the conversations that are really critical in this pedagogy. Sometimes you really break your class up in a different way. People get into small tables and they may have a worksheet. And you can do it in a crummy classroom with, you know, these little benchy seats that we all have to work with. Again, a reconceptualization of a lecture, or in this case, a recitation, which is our, you know, 1 hour a week with a grad student and maybe 30 people instead of 300. Some schools, and the odds are pretty good, that if you go to any institution and get an assistant professor position, they will have at least one room like this. And you should find out about that and ask if you can teach in it. Because when you're teaching in that room, you're not teaching in the 2,000-year-old, you know, it's going to change what you think you need to do. You've got to come up with activities where the students are talking with themselves. You're not the center of attention anymore. They are. There's a lot of that this reconceptualized classroom brings you. CU has one of these rooms, and it's actually, ironically, too small for me to use. It only holds 100 people, and I'm teaching 300, so we got to do other stuff. You can use tools, right? There's the FETSIMs, there's millions of these things, and you'll want to go hunting for them. Just-in-time teaching is a, so I'm now like throwing words at you, so I'm gonna stop. This comes from the Air Force. It's actually a really simple idea. It's so obvious that I, you know, when I heard about it, it was another one of those, I gotta do this. Before lecture, I have one or two conceptual questions that the students have to answer, and it's due an hour before class. So A, they've started thinking about the upcoming material. It's not graded, it's low stakes, but it allows me an hour before lecture, you know, I said, know your students. Well, what a simple way to know what my students think before class starts. So I've got an hour to make some tweaks and changes and think about what I'm gonna do. You can just Google just in time. It's just in time because, right, you're getting the feedback just before lecture. In my class, there's a lot of lecturing. So you don't have to sort of feel like after you hear a talk like this that you've got to put students in small groups and like that's the way they're going to learn. There is a clicker question running in any class, low level, high level, so that they're getting into the classroom mode, they're getting into the topic of the day. And I might have, out of 50 minutes, 20 minutes of me talking. But it's interspersed based on psychological research about, you know, typical 20-year-old attention spans. So that leaves 30 minutes for the student-student conversations. This balance is not, you know, a number that comes from some research paper. It's my intuitions about what works with my population of students. Your mileage may vary. You know, 30 minutes on five questions gives you 6 minutes per question for the students to think, to discuss. Maybe they vote twice. They might vote on their own, and then they might discuss, and they might vote a second time. It's a very good way of, you know, finding out what's going on in the room. And I often will end with a fun, puzzly clicker question so that they have something to think about for the next 2 days that we'll start talking about in the next class. On top of this, just so that my colleagues don't like blame me for watering down the physics curriculum, we give the same old difficult homework questions mixed in with some conceptual questions. I still want students to be able to compute stuff. I would say my exams are more in line with the pedagogy, so I have to think about that. I can't just ask compute Snell's law angles anymore. I got to think about more conceptually focused questions. And next activity. Actually, before we go to the activity, let me just take one quick pause for questions or comments. Anybody got anything that's like bugging you or? Hey, thanks. That on? Okay, so let me repeat in case people didn't hear. The question was specifically about, I would say, math phobia and or lack of math skills. And you were thinking about upper division courses where it becomes really problematic if you're talking about majors. But it's also true at introductory level where some fraction of your class is not starting from the place where you kind of feel you need them to be starting from. So I think we should probably talk about this offline. There are people who study questions of both math and the teaching of math in the context of the sciences. Contextualizing the math can actually help bring a lot of people in so that they begin to see, you know, right, the joke about people are having a conversation at a party and this person says, you know, algebra, what a waste, and who cares about algebra? And the other person says, oh, algebra is awesome. I use it all the time. Oh, what do? I'm an algebra teacher. So, right, so you know, helping the students to see why the math will help them in the course, in their life, is part of the story. So I think I have to defer that one, because it's complicated, and I don't have quick and easy. I typically don't have quick and easy answers for any real question that you have. Okay, so actually, we're going to do another activity. I'm going to be wandering around, so we can actually do kind of individual questions during that period as well.
So this next activity I call Gallery Walk because it's an opportunity to get a chance to look at a variety of questions that you might ask students. Now the questions that I've chosen are not all geoscience questions. There are some in there. There are some from chemistry, physics, math, etc. So the challenge I pose to you when I set you free to look at them is to try to look beyond the content and to not just, again, try not to get too stuck on just figuring out the question and what the answer is, but think about what the question is forcing the student to do and what the teacher might be trying to accomplish by getting the student to think about that question. So the three questions I pose to you as you look at the questions are, number one, if you look, you can see all of these questions are grouped into a group, and each group is grouped by a theme. It's a theme I have in mind. You might end up with other themes that you have in mind. But I want you to try to think about what the sort of unifying theme is for those questions, and the label on each question group you can lift up and you can look underneath it and get the reveal of what I
get
think
the right answer.
Yeah, the right answer. But think about it first. And then I also want you to think about why you might use that type of question. You know, even though it's a physics question, you might be able to use that type of question in your classes. And whether or not there are any questions that you think that are bad, and if you think that they're bad, why you think they're bad. I did seed a couple in there that I think are not the best questions. So the questions are, there's two sets of the questions. All of the ones along this side is one set. All the questions along the brown wall and around the corner are another set. So what I want is for we've got about...
Sets are identical, right?
The identical sets, and within each set there are five different groups, it's a nomenclature. But so what I want is for the folks on this side of the room, so let's say those three tables along that wall plus the two back tables go to those questions, and then these one, two, three, four, five tables go to these questions, and spread out amongst the groups to start, so you're not all trying to 20 people look at one group of questions, and try to only spend like 3 or 4 minutes for each group of questions. If you want to try to see all of them, that will let you see most of them.
And as usual, we're going to cut you off well before you're done with this activity.
Yeah, and talk to each other. This is not a silent activity.
We started gallery walk 2, and so I'll make sure to cut off. Yeah, I'll make sure to cut off everything by 2:20. So I'll
yeah, actually, just cut it off at 2:15 so we can talk a little bit.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I'll end the walk.
Okay, we've run low on time, so finish your thought and please go find your seats. Just out of curiosity, quick show of hands, who was able to get to all five groups of questions? Oh, who got to four of the groups? Okay, so we got a fair way around. First off, anyone spot any stinkers in there? Any questions that you really didn't like? Like I said, I seeded a couple that I wasn't crazy about. Questions you didn't like? Are they too easy, poorly worded? I'll tell you one that I'm not crazy about. It is in group one. Group one was the facts and concepts group. Anyone think of the question I might be referring to in that one? Tectonic plates. I don't know enough geoscience to not know whether or not to like that one. What's wrong with the tectonic plates question? Huh? Boring? Okay, so maybe it's too... Is it too easy? Like the students are all going to get it right? I didn't quite hear that. Could you repeat? Huh? It's traxylene. Okay, so students might be able to answer it without actually understanding the underlying concept. That's important because if that's the case, then the student answers to that question are not going to inform you, and they're not going to inform the students as to where it is that they're having trouble. So that's a good thing to notice. There's another question in group one that I'm not crazy about. It's the Leah and Sue and their ages. I'll tell you, every time you ask a question like that as a clicker question, like, you know, where you're asking students to talk to each other, immediately the room goes silent as everyone turns to their paper and starts scribbling. Now, the calculation questions have a utility, like we still want students to be able to calculate, but they don't tend to, you know, a question like that does not tend to lead to good, rich student discussion. Like, you want to have student discussions around the things that are hard, that students need each other in order to get to the answer. So group one is sort of these facts and concepts questions, which is very similar to the little mini lecture that Steve gave us with the refraction question. And that's pretty common type of question that we might ask either on worksheets or in clicker questions. What are some of the other types of groupings of questions that kind of surprised you or gave you a new way to think of what kinds of tasks you might give your students? Any of those groupings sort of illuminating for you? Yeah. The sparking discussion questions he likes. Why do you like those? So he said you're bringing in discussions around what could be, around like actual physical content, and so you're able to really have an argument, and people might argue for many of those different answers. So this is the questions like, which superpower would you rather have? The ability to change the mass of things, ability to change the charge of things. When I give that question in workshops, usually people say that they want to change the mass because they want to lose weight, but whatever. but those questions where there's not like a right answer, and it's all about the argument, is also really helpful for framing for your students what it means to learn science in your classes. It's not about the right answer, it's about being able to articulate your reasoning and argue a point, to defend a point. That's a much higher level skill than being able to just regurgitate traxylene. Let's see, and then the other groups, so we had facts and concepts. What was group two? Remind me, which one is group two? Is that prediction or is that... Image, that one's images? images. So I put in an example of a worksheet. A lot of the worksheets come from the Science Education Resource Center that I linked in the online resources for this group. One thing that I really envy of you guys in your discipline is that there are a lot of nice ready-made worksheets, clicker questions, et cetera, that you can download. I had one question during the activity as to what is the cost, the sort of startup cost to doing some of these, being able to beg, borrow, and steal resources to run clicker questions or worksheets or whatever in your class is really helpful. So I think I'll end the discussion there on the gallery walk. Did you have anything to add? And turn to our next point. We're doing good. So I want to just pull together some of these ideas of like what do these questions help your students to do by talking about something called backwards design. Okay, I know that's Traxeline again, but it's helpful Traxeline because if you Google backwards design, you'll get a really good framework for organizing your classroom design. So backwards design is the idea that that you first identify where it is you want your students to be. Where are you going? Figure out where you're at, so your student ideas, and then figure out how you're going to bridge the two. How are you going to get there? So when you're designing a class using backwards design, first you figure out what do you want your students to learn. Those are the learning goals that you've got for your students. Then look at those student ideas. So remember, know your audience was our first lesson. And so we want to know where it is that our students already are at. And once we have those two things, where we want our students to go and where our students are already at, then we can design our instruction that helps us to get them there. And then at the end, you want to make sure to assess whether or not students got where you want them to be. So you have lots of different goals that you might have for your students. Conceptual learning, so group one was that sort of conceptual learning you've got for your students. Skills, the ability to perhaps make predictions, so there was the set of questions on experiments and procedures. Learning to learn, you might want your students to be able to become expert learners or reflect on their own learning, or attitudes and beliefs about the subject itself. So, an example conceptual learning goal would be students should be able to identify the geologic processes that generate water resources. So depending on your class, that might be a goal that you have. Being able to articulate a learning goal that's that specific really helps direct your instruction and then helps you write questions like what you just looked at. For attitudes and beliefs, here's an example question. Students should be able to recognize that newsworthy events related to geology occur every day. So that is the kind of so attitude or idea about the topic that we might want students to come away with. When you start with your goals this way, you can then use this to design the actual course. Once you've developed all of these learning goals, it can be very helpful. And then it also makes your assessment really easy because once you've identified exactly what it is you want your students to get out of your class, it's much easier to write the exam. So sort of a tip is that this kind of thing written onto a teaching statement can be very helpful. What kinds of goals do you have for your students? Do you recognize that there are a variety of goals? Can you use backwards design, this idea of setting goals for your students in order to talk about how you'll be teaching courses? So I want to turn it over to Steve to talk about...
I have only one small comment to make about that, which is... when I'm thinking about learning goals, it's easy to be sort of glib about this. So what are my learning goals in Physics 1? I want my students to understand Newton's laws. I want my, right? That's a terrible learning goal. What does it mean, understand Newton's laws? Do I understand Newton's laws? I mean, people are still writing papers in which they're applying these ideas and developing further understanding. So I think the articulation of the learning goals is often best framed as something they can do rather than understanding topic X, because that's ill-defined. So that was just like a little quick comment.
Reminded me of a couple of other things I would mention just to connect it back to the gallery walk. So if ideas about learning are something that you want your students to get, there are all of those questions about asking for your students ideas and attitudes, the survey questions, including like what's difficult for you or which of these procedures is most easy for you to follow. Those kinds of things would explicitly help bring students along in that kind of goal. The images and graphical thinking, perhaps, I know in many of the geosciences, it could be really important for students to have graphical literacy, but if you don't teach it, they're not going to come away with it. So thinking about what kinds of activities or questions to get students to that kind of skill. So that's the sort of match between instruction and goal.
So well, I'd like to sort of wrap up. There is this lesson that if students, you know, I think about this in physics a lot, if they have learned Newton's laws, but, you know, go to a party and say, oh, you're a physicist? I hated physics, right? This is very common and very depressing to me. And to me, I think, you know, morale in the classroom is vital, and it's going to be true in a geosciences course, in a physics course, in any science course. So listening to the students, there's lots of ways to support this, but it's worth being kind of thinking about it explicitly. So here's my summary slides. This is a real book. I think it's a great philosophy of medicine. I think it's an equally great philosophy of teaching. Kill as few patients as possible. So you know, we've said these things. You have to know your audience. Attitudes and beliefs are really important. If all you're doing is talking about concepts all the time, you may not be addressing this. And attitudes and beliefs doesn't just mean I like the class. Attitudes and beliefs might mean learning science means that exam questions are going to be things I've never seen before. That's a belief that I want my students to have that they don't have when they walk into my algebra-based class. They think that science tests are regurgitation tests, and so they're shocked when they actually have to do a lot of work to get them ready for my first exam so that they understand that science is not about remembering. It's about figuring stuff out. Active learning works. This is one of our themes. And, you know, I'm not sure if we've emphasized this, but conceptual understanding doesn't come along for free. Knowing Snell's law doesn't mean that you understand eyeglasses. So starting to pay attention to that explicitly and distinctly will help you as a teacher, because it focuses your attention on things that maybe you didn't have your attention focused to when you were learning that subject. And the natural thing to do when you teach is to do what was done to you. The easiest first thing that you want to do. And here's my last point. I think it's super critical. We're not here trying to give teaching tips. I don't research teaching. I research student learning, and I think that's like a shift in focus that will completely change your teaching. Because it's not about really what you're doing, it's about what's happening to them. And if you keep reminding yourself of that, then you stop paying so much attention to your own activities and stressing about it so much, and you start thinking about assessments and learning goals and activities. And so thinking about a classroom environment as about learning rather than as about teaching is, I think, it's super productive. And so I don't disagree that teaching is an art, but I also want to argue that teaching has scientific aspects to it. You can collect data. You know, I like to joke, I used to do nuclear theory. It's a complex, nonlinear, many-body interacting system, just like teaching. So, right, there's a lot of science that you can do. You all are right now appropriately focused on research in your lives, but you're also thinking about getting jobs where teaching may be an element. And I would like to argue that there's no reason why these have to live in separate silos. So this is my little political pitch. I argue in the physics department sometimes vainly about this. But teaching can be improved by using your science skills and applying them not to questions of geoscience or physics or atmosphere, but to questions of student learning. And when you start to do that, your classrooms change. So I think we'll stop here. Yeah, we'll leave these up as walkaways, and I think we've just used our time. What's next?
Thank you so much. And I think you'll agree that was pretty great. So, and if you can come away from it remembering, how did you feel as a student in this session, and, you know, remembering the techniques that they used, that they were modeling, you know, getting us to talk and walk around, and those are things also, transfer. So thanks again. Thank you.